With the introduction of the update Groundbreaking, Gaijin Entertainment introduced exactly two new top-tier pack premiums. One being the A4E Skyhawk for the Israeli tech tree, and the other one being the German MIG-21 SPS K, which at time of recording of this video resides at 10.0. In today's review, we are going to go over three major points, being the airframe, the weaponry it can hold, and the conclusion to find out if it is worth its price. So let us jump into the airframe. Cutting it short, the MIG-21 SPS-K airframe is a carbon copy of the MIG-21 PFM of the Russian tech tree. That's it. Nothing was changed. It has the same gun pod, it has the same engine, and it's the same flight model. Now, this can be on one hand something really good, and on the other hand something very bad. The SPS-K and the PFM really struggle with two major things. Acceleration and energy bleed. The first one we get to in just a second, and the second one is kind of obvious. The SPS-K is a delta wing plane, meaning that as soon as you start pulling some certain degree of angle of attack, you are going to bleed loads and loads and loads of your energy. This doesn't happen with planes like the MiG-19 or the A5 Cancer. This might also be a point why you might perform with the SPS-K well, or you might not perform well with the SPS-K if you're not used to knowing that pulling once on your stick is going to result in you losing most of your energy. And then we have the second problem, being the acceleration. When we look at a plane like the MiG-21 BIS or the SMT, we both know that those planes have a pretty powerful engine, especially the BIS having access to its two-stage emergency afterburner for basically all its duration. Its acceleration is ridiculous and means that even if you pull loads of angle of attack, it doesn't matter, you can still go on and go on without even coming close to stalling because your engine has this much power. It is not as good as of a raid fighter as something like SU-17 M2 would be, or the new MiG-23 MLD, but MiG-21 BIS can still pull quite a lot hard turn and keep pulling that turn. The PFM has a very good initial turn rate. It really knows how to use that, and if you know how to use it, you will not have a big problem. It means that when you are fighting against things like the Harrier or the AV-8A, which are a BR-9.7 at the moment, you will not have an issue keeping at their heels, as they simply cannot pull enough angle of attack and enough hard to get you off their six. However, depending how hard you are pulling, they will lose a lot less energy and are able to speed away from you. This is especially frustrating because the AV-8A and C versions have loads of flares without having to give up anything. Meaning that if you, for example, were able to close the distance to an AV-8A, for example, you didn't got a shot off and then you decide to hunt him down with a missile, chances are very high, if they know even slightly what they are doing, your missile is not going to get even close to hitting them because of their flares. And they will just start to out-accelerate you, and you are sitting there in the dust until you can get going again. Because the top speed of the PFM and the SPS-K is not that bad. You can comfortably break mark on the deck at around 1.05, maybe even 1.1 without even speed ripping, which is something of the fastest values at 10.0 and below. At your BR, you are basically able to out-turn everything in the initial turn, and you're able to burn loads of energy. However, as soon as you don't have that energy left anymore, you guessed it, you are a sitting duck. Notable enemies you shouldn't try to turn fight are definitely the freaking J35A, the Draken at 9.7. Yes, it only has 4 AIM-9B clones, but that thing is scary. It accelerates quickly, it has loads of angle of attack, and it can consistently keep on turning while you can't really. And the 30mm are devastating if they hit. Another notable enemy would be the A5 Cancer, as it has an air spawn, it has loads of energy when you are turning, it has great energy retention while you don't, and if you try to hunt them down, the problem is they have some flares on board while also still having guns and two magic missiles. And those magic ones, they are epic. Now let's move on to the weaponry. First things first, you are able to decide if you want to take even the gun port or if you want to exchange it for an ECM, aka a chaff and flare pod, the same one we have at the moment on the MIG-21 Bissau, as well as on the MIG-21 MF, as well as the MIG-21 SMT. It provides with 64 countermeasures, which is more than enough to flare away any incoming missile which isn't a sky flash. However, in my playtime of this vehicle, which now includes 36 games, I have to say, I just simply feel like the gun pod is a necessity. At the moment, there are so many planes you're fighting which can just flare away your missile. I just feel like it is better for you to learn how to use the gun pod and how to missile dodge without flares. It will help you later in the long run, as well as I feel like half of my kills I have in the SPS K are simply done with the gun. The gun needs some time to get used to because it's very, very, very low. However, if you get used to it, it's a pretty potent knife fighter. So now let's talk about the elephant in the room and why exactly the SPSK is at the moment at 10.0. This thing can decide between several different missile loadouts. You can decide to take 4 R3Ss, which are the AIM-9B equivalent, making you basically like the Draken A. Then you can decide to take 4 radar guided missiles, being the R3Rs. Or you can take a mix between 2 AIM-9Bs, Russian AIM-9Bs, and 2 R3Rs, which would be an okay-ish loadout if this thing would be at 9.7. At 10.0, however, those radar guided missiles are simply nothing to write home about. They are simply meh, at least. Yes, you are able to try and get some space clamping Harriers, but don't forget, things like the AV-8 A and C, they have RWR radar warning receivers, meaning that they will know you are locking you up. Obviously, they can't really flare or chaff your missile away, because for some reason that doesn't work, but they are able to dodge those missiles easily as they only pull 10 Gs. Speaking of RWR, the SPSK has a rudimentary form of a RWR. It is the SPO2 version, which means it is only a small panel giving you one directional RWR, and this direction is at the back of your plane. It's really not helpful. It is there, but it's not helpful. Because usually, if you are getting radar locked, it is usually from the front, and then you get slapped in the face by a Sparrow or a Sky Flash. Then there are 2 more missile loadouts, being the R13s, which are decently better than the R3Ss, however they are not the R13 M1s, meaning they don't pull 25G, and lastly we have the R60, which will most likely be your best loadout. The R60 is just in general an amazing close combat missile. It pulls 30 Gs, it is very quick, and it just feels epic to use. Another great feature I highly recommend for you to learn is to use the radar slaving technology, meaning that you can radar lock the enemy in front of you, you can warm up the missile, and then you can already pull ahead of the enemy so that missile has to pull less, and it just works. Yes, the radar slaving doesn't ignore flares, but yeah, that's just how it is. In general though, radar slaving is great to use with the SPSK and R60s. You also have some ground pounding capabilities with 2 Fab 500 bombs, or 2 Fab 250 bombs, or 2 S-24 rockets, or 64 S-5K rockets. You do not have a ballistic computer, but it still might be worth a shot. However, I think for ground pounding there are better options in the German tech tree, maybe not at 10.0, but I still think even at high tier you could in theory still use the G91R4, if you not get slammed out of the sky by a SAM. Let's wrap this up with the conclusion and see if this thing is really worth it. At the moment we have 4 different planes at 10.0 and 10.3 being premiums. The F5C being an amazing gun fighter and having loads of chaff and flare and a proper RWR paired with a decent missile, the AIM-9E, but it's obviously nothing like the R60. Then obviously we have the Harrier GR1, which comes with an air spawn, with some bombs, and 4 SRAMs, aka the SRAMs, aka the Vector Thrustering Cancer. They only work at around 1 kilometer, but they are deadly as hell if you do not have flares. Then we also have the A5 Cancer, which, as you know, has an air spawn, has some bombs, and has 2 magic missiles as well as some flares and chaff, being in my opinion still the top dog of the 10.0 premium bracket. And then we have the MIG-21 SPS K. I don't know, at the moment for 60 bucks or 60 euros or 60 Gaijin, I think it is not really worth it. Yes, it can be a very capable fighter in the hands of people which know what they are doing. If you don't know what you are doing, it will be rather tough to get your way out of it. Because obviously, if you just come from early game, when you just come from props or so, you think, oh yeah, I can just keep on turning and turning and turning, but then you're just a sitting duck because you wasted all of your energy. Energy management, in my opinion, is quite hard in SPSK if you're still new to jets, because you simply lose it so quickly, and having no energy left is usually a death sentence. Plus, because I do think it is worth to use the gun pod rather than the flare pod, you also need to learn how to look around and see if you can evade some missiles by missile chinking. The thing is though, when we now look at the premium loadout which Germany has at the moment for their top tier, the SPSK is the only real option. No other plane goes all the way up to rank 7 as their research efficiency. Both the R4 as well as the Seahawk Mark 100 only go towards rank 6, and after that you would need to start using one of those planes. I still think the MiG-19S is an amazing fighter, and I highly recommend for you to try it out and learn it. I have the MiG-19 PT. It is hard to keep going with it and it is hard to learn it, but if you learn it, you learned loads about energy management and how to use your amazing raid capabilities. So yeah, worth it for 60 euros? Not really. Worth it at 10.0? Yes and no. It does work at 10.0, but as soon as you get up tier to 10.7 or even 11.0, you are outclassed. Everything at 11.0 is faster, better and more potent than you. If you want to climb at 11.0, good luck, you'll most likely die to a sky flash. I would say if you really want a premium for Germany to grind out the new MiG-21 Bissau or the F4F Light, the SPSK is definitely not a wrong step. I do think though for 60 euros it is a little bit too expensive. I would suggest to you to wait until there is a sale where this thing is on sale, because with a 30% discount or even a 50% discount, yes, it is definitely more worth it. In that case, this video is over. I thank you so much for watching. My name is RagingRaptor. Don't forget to check out my latest video about the Israeli tech tree, or the other video being about if War Thunder is a replacement for World of Tanks. Cheers, and I'll see you around.